welcome to Contact. I'm Gloria Creighton, and with me here today at Anderson's restaurant is Svend Robinson, MP for Burnaby Kingsway. Welcome, Svend.
Thanks, Gloria. Good to be here.
Good to have you here. I know you're extremely busy these days, and right after this interview, you're running off to chat with how many thousand
seniors? Oh, not a thousand, a couple hundred seniors, yeah.
Why the interest?
I've always been interested, even before I got into politics. I was involved with New Vista Senior mm-hmm. Citizens Housing. I enjoy the challenge, and I enjoy working with seniors. I mean, they've had such incredible experience, many of them. They've got a lot to, I think, to educate us about. And as a younger person myself, I enjoyed that. And let's face it, the population is an aging population as well, and so a lot of the concerns that seniors have got to be reflected in the political process also.
That certainly makes sense, and we're all getting there.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I must say, Sven, it's good to have you. I know extremely busy, not only politically, but you're involved. You're on so many boards. You're honorary member of so many different boards, and you're chairing so many committees. A lot, human rights, minorities groups, the disabled, native, and it goes on and on. So I was picturing, I've seen pictures of you in the paper, but I must say, between you and I, I'm surprised to see you looking so fresh and fit.
Well,
what's your secret?
Sometimes
I mean, just being in politics
can be deceiving,
itself.
But no, I mean, yeah. Obviously, it seems to me that I think one of the most important things in politics is to try to have some sense of balance mm-hmm. in your life. And God knows it's taken me a long time, and I'm not sure I've achieved that. But you know, you've got to recognize that there's more to life than politics. And one of the, I think, toughest aspects of politics, and I think any politician will tell you this, is the toll it takes on your personal life, in terms of personal relationships, in terms of time, and so on. So that's very tough. But at least if you make some time for yourself, spend time with friends, get out, get involved in sports, the outdoors for me is particularly important, you can retain some semblance of sanity anyway.
Right. And do you make that time often? Because I know today's Saturday, and here you are doing this interview and running off to this meeting.
Yeah, I try to. Sometimes I succeed better than others. I tend to live my life in chunks, actually. I tend to work incredibly hard for a chunk of time
and then just
take off. Yeah, exactly. This summer, for example, I was over in Denmark doing some cycling. You know, met some friends over there, threw a pack on my back, and we got on our bikes and went cycling for 10 days and forgot all about politics. So. Yeah, as long as you know you're able to get away like that, I think you can retain some.
Well, I think you pretty well have to.
Yeah.
With your plate is quite loaded,
exactly.
So you've got to do it.
Yeah.
Well, good for you. Keep up the good work. You also have developed quite a reputation as being a very outspoken advocate of human rights.
Well,
why human rights? I mean, it's obvious, but it could be
environment.
For me,
yeah. I mean, for me, there's got to be sort of a driving force that runs you. And keeps you going, gives you some sense of direction and vision in politics and political life. You've got to have a reason for being there. And I guess what I've tried to do, sometimes more successfully than others to be sure, but what I've tried to do is to look at groups in our society and individuals in our society that perhaps have traditionally been powerless and voiceless and who look not just to me, but look to New Democrats, look to Audrey McLaughlin, and historically to New Democrats for some sense of leadership. And for me, that's been, you know, very important. And also, when you look at some of the, I think, more unpopular groups in our society, groups that have historically been victims of discrimination, whether it's gays and lesbians, whether it's people with disabilities, religious minorities,
right.
You know, it seems to me that when you've got access to the media, when you've got access to a public forum, that you use it. And you try to communicate some of the concerns and values and objectives of those communities, and that's what I've tried
Wonderful.
To do.
Wonderful. Well, we certainly need more of that. Speaking about human rights, how does Canada rate on a global scale?
You know, it's interesting to ask that question because, you know, the United Nations recently did a survey of all of the countries in the world, and Canada came out number one overall. And I think that's right, quite frankly.
Do you?
And I think that we have a magnificent country. I think we have potential that we haven't even begun to realize. But we've also got to recognize that within this country, there are some very serious obstacles to justice. And, you know, if you're a young Aboriginal person today, for example, you've got a better chance of going to jail than you do of going to university. It's a national shame, our treatment of Aboriginal peoples historically. So I think that's one area that we've really obviously got to come to terms with. If you're a lesbian, you can be thrown out of your job without any recourse whatsoever at the federal level. We have no human rights protection whatsoever for lesbians, gay men, bisexuals at the federal level.
How about the Charter of Rights, Section 15?
Well, Section 15...
I know you worked on that. You were quite active.
Yes, and I was very involved in that. And certainly the Charter will provide some important human rights protection against government action. But we need human rights legislation to deal with...
So we need new legislation?
We need, absolutely, we need new legislation as well. And that's very important. And we're not, I think it's important to emphasize too, we're not talking about special rights for anybody.
No, we're just talking about basic human rights.
We're talking about basic equality. And one of the things that I think is special about Canada is that we should celebrate the diversity of our community. I mean, we have so many unique and wonderful things. I mean, this is a bilingual country.
Our native peoples,
Aboriginal peoples, we have many different cultural communities in this country. We're not the melting pot of the United States. We are a mosaic, and I think we should celebrate that. Instead, what I see, and it's very troubling, is more and more this tendency on the part of the current political leadership in Ottawa to drive us into sort of the more of the American values. Well, I don't like that. I don't like what I see there, whether it's the trade deal, whether it's Brian Mulroney's close relationship with Bush on a whole range of foreign policy issues. We're a different country. We're a different society.
So there's a lot of work to be done, and yet we're rating number one. What does that say for the other countries and the rest of the world?
Well, yeah. I mean, again, I think we have to recognize that. I mean, look at what we have going for us. We have the second largest country in the world. We have a skilled and educated workforce. We have resources. We have everything here in this country. And yet, I think never have the tensions in the country been greater, whether it's tensions between Quebec and the rest of Canada, the sense of betrayal that Aboriginal peoples feel at the historic denial of their rights.
Speaking of Aboriginal peoples, Sven, just to interrupt you for a second, you've been honored also by the Haida for helping them in their, you know, the Haida Gwaii and the Charlottes. Mm-hmm. Is that safe now for them?
Well, certainly Haida Gwaii is it's a magnificent area, and that particular struggle in the mid-80s was to save what's called South Moresby, particularly Lyell Island. And it was Aboriginal peoples themselves, particularly the elders, Ada Yovanovitch, other elders that really were the courageous people there. I was privileged to be able to be there and to show my solidarity with them. But I mean, they were the courageous people. When you ask, has it been saved? There will be no logging there. But I think we have to recognize that we've got to go far beyond that in terms of breaking the cycle of dependency. The Haida Nation is a nation. And yet, there's still far too much unemployment. There are still serious threats to the environment in that area that we've got to address as a community.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of Aboriginal people again and the Charlottetown Accord, Native self-government, there's a terrible controversy over that. People are absolutely up in arms about so many different tribes and businesses will be lost, and there will be chaos if this happens. What are your feelings on that?
Oh, look, I think there's been a lot of scaremongering, fearmongering about the real implications of this. All we are saying is that Aboriginal peoples have always had the right to self-government. It's been there long before we first touched on these shores, and all of us are immigrants, let's face it. They've always had that. That's always been there. And yet what happened is we imposed our system of government, an alien form of government, on them through the Indian Act. And it's had devastating consequences. I mean, you look at the level of infant mortality, of youth suicide. You look at our prisons and the number of Aboriginal peoples in our prisons, the level of unemployment. You go down to Maine and Hastings and see the broken people down there. Yeah. It's not working.
It's in front of our eyes every day of the week.
It's not working. The system we have now is not working.
So what is the solution?
And I think that self-government is a very important step in that direction. We've got this massive bureaucracy in the Department of Indian Affairs. Let Aboriginal peoples take control over their own lives and their own destiny. Shouldn't threaten us at all. I mean, we should be able to work with Aboriginal peoples. We've got a lot to learn from them in terms of respect for the environment, for example. A lot to learn. But the other element is resolution of land claims. It seems to me self-government, and then there's got to be an economic base. Those are the two, I think, most fundamental concerns.
To get back to the Accord for a bit, do you support the Accord?
Yes, although I guess by the time that this program is aired...
It'll have been resolved.
It will have been resolved.
That's
and at this point, it looks like it's probably toast. But, there were certainly... it was not an easy decision for me to make. But on balance, I feel quite strongly that it's a reasonable compromise. There's certainly areas that I'd want to see strengthened, but we've reached out to Quebec to say, look, I mean, this is what we recognize. You are a distinct society. We want to keep you in this country. Now, if Quebec says no, fair enough. I mean, that's, you know, they will have said no. This is not enough. For supporters of independence, nothing will be enough. They want an independent country. We've reached out to Quebec. We've reached out to Aboriginal peoples. We in the West, I think, have become stronger under the provisions of the Senate reforms. And we've got a social charter that reaffirms some of the basic social and economic values of this country. So I think it's a pretty good compromise. I'd like to see us get on to other issues as well. Mm-hmm. But the way it looks at this point, as we speak, it looks like it's going down.
It's going down. And what will be the consequences of that? Is it going to be doom and gloom? As
the consequences, I think, I mean, I'm not one of the sort of sky is falling, you know, group.
Well,
we're hearing a lot of that. And frankly, the campaign, the Yes campaign, by and large, has been disastrous. Yeah. I mean, it's been really appalling. Threats, intimidation, you know, we haven't been stressing the positive elements of the accord. And let's face it, a lot of people want to shoot the messenger and not the message. You know, Brian Mulroney is not exactly the most popular leader in the country. But I am deeply concerned that, for example, now Aboriginal peoples will be told, well, tough luck, you know. I mean, you had your chance here, the country said no, so it's business as usual. We will be stuck with this monstrosity of a Senate that we have now. I mean, this bunch of hacks and flacks and political has-beens, you know, and it's an embarrassment in a democratic society. We're stuck with that. So I think that there's some problems, certainly, that we're going to have to address, and one of the most serious is clearly that Quebec will, I think, have taken a lot further, many more steps towards ultimately leaving this country.
So Canada will no longer be Canada as we know it. You see things changing drastically?
That's the direction in which we're moving now. And, you know, we're if that happens, there's going to be a very strong tug from the United States, inevitably, mm-hmm. if Quebec leaves. And that society, I think, while it has many strengths, that's not the kind of country I want to see. I mean, we're already seeing massive threats to the survival of this country with the trade deal, especially
right.
if it's extended to Mexico.
Yeah. You're also involved with external affairs and international trade,
yeah.
so you're a good person to speak about this. What are your feelings?
Well, I mean, Mel Hurdick has said this is the last chance for Canada, you know, and in many respects, I think he's right. We've suffered massive job losses under the Canada-U.S. trade deal. Everybody remembers all those jobs we were promised. Well, they haven't materialized, and now they want to extend it to Mexico. It's not good for working people in Mexico. It's disastrous for us here in Canada. I mean, how are we going to compete against cheap Mexican
labor?
No,
we can't.
Environmental standards, which are almost non-existent, no worker health and safety. So that's a real concern. But also, if we have this pull from the States, I mean, there's things like health care. One of the things that I'm proudest of as a Canadian, and I might say particularly as a New Democrat, was the role that we played, Tommy Douglas and others played, in developing national health insurance. 37 million Americans have no health insurance at all. If they get sick and they're poor, they've had it. And, well, I don't want to be part of that kind of society. And yet I see more and more pressure on us to kind of incorporate some of those values. You see it in the trade deal, you see it in the extension of the trade deal, I think we've got to send a pretty clear message, hopefully soon, that this is not acceptable.
Do you, this is a personal question, as a politician, do you at times have a conflict with what your party supports, and do you always have to go along with what your leader supports? You know, there are times when your conscience says, no, I, say, want to vote another way, and the party leader says, we've got it for solidarity. Does this happen to you?
Oh, sure.
What do you do about it?
It's very tough. I mean,
yeah.
Let's face it, no one's ever going to agree with all of the policies that the party has, but it seems to me you've got to make a decision. Where are you most comfortable? I mean, what are the broad directions that you know, you think the country should be going in, and then which party most closely reflects that? And I guess I'm particularly comfortable now with the kind of leadership, the style of leadership that Audrey McLaughlin is bringing. Mm-hmm. It's very new. A lot of the old boys in Ottawa don't like it. It's a consensus model. It's reaching out to groups that have historically not been part of the mainstream of the political process. And a lot of the old boys feel threatened by that. But I think it's great, and I think it's about time that we rejected some of this old style of politics. There, of course, there have been times when my views have clashed, and in some cases I've publicly stated those differences with my party. And, you know, you pay a price, inevitably. But fundamentally, you got to be able to look at yourself in the mirror in the morning. And if, you know, you've maintained some sense of integrity and respect for the basic principles that you're there for, then I think, you know, there are going to be differences from time to time, but hopefully you'll remain on track.
Good. Why NDP, Sven? You've been with the NDP since 1969?
Since 66.
Oh, 66, yeah. All right.
My first election campaign.
And you were the youngest.
Yeah, that's right.
Remember when you joined?
I remember distributing leaflets for Eileen Daly back in 1966 with my mom up in North Burnaby. I think that probably, much of that came from my family, from my mother and my father. I mean, they had very deep socialist values, humanitarian values. And certainly to the extent that I have those, I owe an enormous debt of gratitude to my family, particularly to my parents for helping to open my eyes to what some of the concerns were. And so it was logical for me, having grown up in that kind of environment, it was logical for me to look to a party which was a party of protest, if you will. Sometimes I worry that we're becoming a little too complacent, you know, and we're drifting from some of those values that drove us and that should continue to drive us, those values of justice and fundamental changes to the economic and social system. Power can be an enormously corrosive thing. I mean, it's a wonderful thing, but, you know, it's important that we remember why we're there as well. So,
On that note, was it Alan Fotheringham described you as one of the most conscientious and effective politicians in Ottawa?
Yeah, well, despite that, I think I do. Okay.
Yeah. Can you elaborate on that? Does that mean that you work harder?
I don't know. I'm not the best person to be in charge of how effective I am, but I do work hard. I mean, I love this job.
Is that what it is?
I mean, I think I'm in one of the most magnificent jobs that any person could have in this country. I mean, to have the privilege of representing a great community, you know, the community of Burnaby Kingsway that I represent, that I grew up in, to be able to speak out publicly on issues that you care about deeply, to also, for better or for worse, as the only openly gay member of Parliament, to have the privilege of speaking on behalf of that community, I feel tremendously, it's great to be there.
So you're here because you want to be.
Yeah, absolutely.
Something you've always wanted. On the other hand, are there a lot of people in politics who shouldn't be there? I'm just saying this because I think generally people now have become mistrustful of politicians and tired.
Yeah.
And
I think that's right. And I think I've got a real fear that people are discrediting the whole political process.
Yeah, this is.
And they're sort of saying you're all a bunch of crooks. You're all dishonest.
This is happening.
Yeah, there's an erosion of credibility, and the danger of that is that, you know, if you destroy the political culture in this country, and sure, there are bad politicians, but, you know, the vast majority of politicians, and I'm not just speaking to Democrats, I'm speaking about all politicians, the vast majority of politicians are people that feel very deeply about their country, about their community, about their province, that get in there because they want to make a difference. Now,
do things happen along the way?
Sometimes things happen along the way, but I think it's a real problem now because people don't, they have contempt for all politicians in many cases, you know, and I think they've got to recognize that if the democratic process breaks down, what does that lead to? It leads to decisions. I mean, decisions are still going to have to be made.
Yeah. And I think people are not thinking clearly either, like with the vote, the yes, no, they're tired, they're distrustful, so they're not really thinking it out. They're just voting one way, I guess, out of
there's a real
fatigue.
Anger.
There's a real sense of anger
out there. And, and again, I understand that. I mean, for too long, people have rightly said, well, the politicians aren't listening to us. I mean, we're fed up. They shove the GST down our throats. I mean,
I asked you this question because people don't say that of you. You have a good reputation.
Well,
so
I mean,
that's
to the
why
extent
I hit you
that,
with that one.
Yeah,
so.
I mean, to the extent that I've
people can reach you.
Yeah, I mean, I've tried to be accessible. Yeah. As if I've got a storefront office on Hastings,
that's
you know,
right.
and and people know that as their member of Parliament, that if they've got a problem, they come to see me. Yeah. They're going to get some action. I've got very hardworking and dedicated staff as well, and that makes a
difference. And you got a lot of trust out there, and there were some other politicians that do also. But I think the majority, it's the air that we have now is people are mistrustful and tired.
I think that's right.
Yeah. So it's got to change.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah.
Can we go on to environmental issues for a bit, Sven? What do you think about the statement Canada is the Brazil of the North, and our logging? Is it as gloomy as is painted?
I think we have a very serious crisis in this province. And I think unless we wake up to that crisis soon, there are not going to be jobs in the forest industry that many years from now. And, you know, we've got to do this in a spirit of dialogue, not of confrontation, but we've got to do it in a way that recognizes reality.
There's so much anger happening between
But there's a lot of uncertainty. I mean, and you can't blame people that are working in the forest industry for saying, well, you know, it's all well and good for you to say that that our practices are destructive, but you know, I've got a mortgage and I've got kids to feed and I've got a future to look to. And we can't just dismiss those fears. But on the other hand, what we've got to understand is that time is running out, that the kind of destructive forest policies that we have had and we continue to have in this province are a recipe for disaster. And you know, you just have to fly over Clackwit Sound, for example, on the west coast of Vancouver Island, fly over some of the other areas in which there have been massive clear cuts. You see the erosion, you see the destruction. There's an island up in Haida Gwaii in the Queen Charlotte's called Tulunquin Island. It's like a moonscape. And it's this greed, it's this cut-and-run philosophy. It's looking at forests as fiber instead of as magnificent biological diversity that we have to preserve, particularly the old-growth forests. Right.
Haven't we learned from Europe what happened in Germany and what they're doing now? They think our practices are appalling because they've been through it.
Well, yeah, but the problem is that unfortunately, forest companies are making a lot of money from these practices, and we're not looking to the future. I mean, the Haida have a saying that I think is very appropriate. They say, you know, we don't inherit this earth from our ancestors. We borrow it from our children. Well, we're betraying our children.
What a different way of looking at things.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, we're not looking to the future, whether it's in the Amazon, whether it's in Sarawac, where the Panan people
are
literally...
That's right, you were down in Sarawac recently.
Yes, that's right.
And what did you see there?
Well, what I saw is a people who are on the edge of disaster. Their way of life, the rainforest, is being cut at a rate that is totally unsustainable. And within a very few years, it's going to be all over for those people. So, I mean, we are one tiny planet. And until we start to recognize that we've got to work together to save this planet, and we start listening to the voices of people like David Suzuki, who are not being alarmist, but are saying this is our future, and communicating with those who feel threatened by these changes, we've got some real problems.
Now, the NDP has certainly done something to help out the environment in regard to wilderness areas. Mm-hmm. Are there more of that? Can we look forward to more of that happening from the
NDP? I certainly hope so, yeah. I'm a little bit impatient. I think we could be doing more.
Yeah.
You know, we have, I think, got some very good policies. We're doubling the amount of parkland in British
That's
Columbia,
right.
which is very important.
It's wonderful.
And very significant. We've made some major steps forward in a number of areas. We've identified, you know, a number of areas that should not be logged, that at least should potentially be saved. I'm concerned that in some of them the logging is going on while we're studying them, and there may be nothing left to save. I'm very concerned about the agricultural land reserve. I fundamentally disagreed with the decision to remove the agricultural land in Kamloops when the cabinet overruled mm-hmm. the agricultural land reserve.
Right.
And I very much hope that the promise that we've now made, that Bill Barley has made as agriculture minister, to end cabinet appeals and political interference in those kind of decisions will actually happen.
How about we haven't been hearing recently because of the accord, and I think forestry is the big issue now, but in the summertime we were hearing a lot about the ozone. We've had that little warning and CFCs. Does the New Democrat Party have anything stand on that? Or?
Yeah. In fact, I think this is one of the greatest threats globally. Yeah. It's the whole question of global warming and the ozone layer. And one of the real disappointments out of Rio and the UNCED conference, the big environmental conference in Rio, was that we didn't really come to grips with that, with some tough, effective, enforceable standards. The other, I think, great disappointment in Rio is that because of the destructive lobbying of the Vatican, that we didn't even deal with the issue of population. Mm-hmm. And that's something else that as a planet and as people, we're going to have to come to grips with, population growth.
And we tend to ignore it sometimes, but we see Somalia in the news or have been, and it's passed and we get on with our lives.
Exactly.
Yeah. How about your spare time? Let's get back to that. You enjoy kayaking, cycling?
Yeah, I like the outdoors, actually. I've got a sea kayak.
And you've just taken up whitewater rafting.
I'm starting to learn whitewater kayaking.
I just
learned the Eskimo roll, right?
Do your constituents know about this?
Well, they do now.
Because that can be pretty risky, can it not?
I suppose it can, but what's life without a few risks? You know, I mean, I enjoy the outdoors. I love the outdoors, and I mean, we're such a magnificent province here in British Columbia. We can do that. I like skiing very much, getting out and going up to Blackcomb and doing some skiing.
Good, so you'll do your bit to help preserve the environment, Sven.
Certainly will.
Because you're appreciating it. Our time is almost up, but do you have any aspirations to be premier one day, or?
Oh, I mean,
has it gone through your mind?
Look, I enjoy the job I've got.
Yeah.
I enjoy it tremendously.
Yeah.
Would I like to be part of a government one day?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Of course, I'd like to be part of a government to be able to implement some of the policies that I'm advocating now and not just be a critic. So, sure, but I'd like to be part of an Audrey McLaughlin government.
Okay, well, good luck to you in the future, and we'll let you run off to your meeting and have a good lecture and keep up the good work.
Thank you very
much. Thanks for taking time out of your busy day to come and chat with us.
Good to be here.
I'd also like to take this opportunity to thank Andersons for providing this lovely setting for the interviews. For Contact, I'm Gloria Creighton. Please join us next time.